Call the meeting to order, 18:30. Flag salute.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, roll call. Mr. Turner.
Present.
Mr. Langer.
Present.
Ms. Hawks.
Present.
Prince, not here.
Excuse me.
I'm here. Dr. Bethman.
Here.
Okay. All right. No addition.
Nope.
Nope.
Just...
public comment. Items that are on the agenda.
Okay.
Nope. Okay.
We have a hand raised.
I don't know what all the items on the agenda are, but Ed said there might be something that is relevant to me. Could I make a comment?
If you want to sign in real quick.
Okay. I just don't know what the protocol is. I just wanted to do a shout out to Ed Dowell on behalf of all the Eagle Scouts that he's assisted doing the projects on the high school premises. My husband had hoped to say something more, I don't know, nicer than I am, but he's not here. So I thought since we're here, this is a good opportunity to give a shout out. He's been very supportive through three Eagle Scout projects my kids have done at the high school and gone out of his way to help us with staging things in advance, spaces for us, and being responsive to their communications. So he's gone above and beyond. We know other Eagle Scouts that have had more difficulties with facilities getting projects done, and he's been very supportive. And it's an asset to the community to be able to put these things together with his assistance. Just wanted to do that on behalf of my family to Ed before everybody. So,
there he
is. I'm sorry.
Thank you.
We agree. Ed is Mr. Wonderful. If it wasn't for him, we'd be in a lot of trouble on a weekly basis.
Okay, recognition. College Board Big Future Award.
Yes, so we have three students here that are going to be recognized, and Mr. Theonis is here to recognize them. We are really honored to have them here so the board can recognize them and hear about just a little bit of their accomplishments and how they deserve this recognition.
Hello, good evening. Nice to be here, not having to do a report. So the order up there is Grace Morgan and Gunnar Morgan and Yana Mador. So these guys performed very well on the PSAT, and I heard Yana talking about scoring real high on the AP biology test, which I never had the guts to even try. So my hat's off to you. These guys obviously are very high academic flyers for us as students, and they do a great job representing our school and our community. And, when we got this notification, I immediately asked my boss, can we recognize these guys? Because it's not too often, you know, they put in a lot of long hours working hard and studying, and they do a lot of stuff behind the scenes, and it's very rare that they get recognized. So this is a great opportunity. And so first designation is Grace Morgan for rural performance in the College Board Big Future Award. Come on up, Grace. So stay up here, and then we're going to get a picture with you and the board. Congratulations. Then Gunnar Morgan, probably been out running how many miles today?
not too many, even 4 weeks.
All right, taking it easy. And then Yana Mador, come on up.
Oh.
Congratulations, all you got. And then where do you want them at?
We're going to stand right in front of the flag.
Okay, right in front of the flag, okay.
Can I get one of just Gunner for my cross country?
Sure.
Double duty. You don't need the.
Here, I'll hold on. We want to get all wrinkled.
Cross country team.
Yes.
I might have saw him.
Okay. Thank you.
And then the board wants to take a picture with you over here by the flags, guys.
So all the board can join, or we'll just have our president, whatever you'd like.
I have a question. Did they score real high in their exams?
No, I was going to, while they're getting their picture, I thought I'd tell you a little bit more.
I'm going to take it from this.
Mr. Only Home.
Yeah, well, it was quick and fast.
Yeah.
want to close that?
Good luck.
And Monday after.
You guys all going to get up against.
Is that like
yep.
station?
We're going to do it right against the flag.
Come on, British. I know in Rochester.
And is there room for everybody? Because if there is, we could have the whole board with them.
Okay.
Susie. What if we do here? I'm going to organize real quick. What if we do the two?
Yeah,
Grace
front
right
yep.
here.
Make more room.
Shauna, right here. Got that. There we go. There we go. Okay.
One, two, three.
Okay. All right. Let's yeah. So as we're sitting back down, I'll explain just a little bit more of what I dug into this award. This is actually one of the first years that College Board is doing the Big Future Award, or it's maybe the second, but it's a relatively new award. And they look for students who are, they consider underrepresented. So students from a rural background, or students who are Hispanic, or students who are Black, or students who are low income. There were some other big areas. But they're looking for unrepresented students who perform well. And I believe it was either on your PSAT or an AP test that you took. So, and when it says performed well, you performed better than most of the students. And especially students who were in the same student group as they were looking at when they identified students. From what I can tell, these students are selected and then they don't say, you know, Grace, you will have a scholarship, but they put them in a pool. And every month they will be pulling names out of the pool and they could receive a scholarship from $400 up to $40,000.
Go for that one.
So, yeah. So College Board's a big program. They basically run the AP and the SAT and the PSAT. And colleges, when you're applying for colleges, look for recognition like this on resumes and on letters of recommendations and things. So this is a really good honor to be recognized by College Board because these are students across the country who are going to want to be going to college. And we have three of the kids who've been recognized. So congratulations, you guys. We're
cool.
proud of you. And we look forward to see what's going on next in your life.
When you...
Iana, right?
Yes.
Okay. Iana took the AP biology test and earned a 3, which is a passing score on the biology test. And that is a really tough AP test. That and physics are two of the very difficult ones. So congratulations on getting a 3 on AP bio. That's, are you taking any AP classes this year?
I am in a couple EWU classes.
There you go.
So I'm taking political science and I'm in statistics.
Oh, great. Okay, good. So you're going to be getting college credit that way. Nice job. How about Gunner? What do you?
Test or classes? What are you asking?
Both. A little bit. How about classes? Did you take any AP tests last year?
We're running CERT students.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you're right. That's right. I knew that. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
So how are your classes going this year? So you're getting a full load of college credits, right?
I'd like to think so. Yeah. Straight A's for whatever that's worth.
A lot.
I enjoy them, you know.
What are you taking this quarter?
This particular quarter, I'm taking statistics, nutrition science, and public speaking. Next quarter, I'll be taking calculus and political science and biology for the lab. I have the next spring quarter probably planned out too.
Fabulous.
Anthropology, biological anthropology, intro to philosophy, and something else. Chemistry.
Oh, just a simple one like that, huh? Well, congratulations, you guys. We are really impressed and proud to say that you are from Rochester. So thank you for being here. If you want to stay for the rest of the meeting, you are more than welcome. But I do want to let you know, maybe you want to wait till after your student reps give their reports and then you can duck out, or but you do not have to stay for the entire meeting. You don't even have to stay another second longer if you want. I understand if you have things to do. So They do most of it in the classwork. I don't know if they have them do like action. So, I don't know.
Okay,
are we ready? Moving on.
I don't know how that.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Your public speaking class, do you have to go out and give a public speech anywhere?
Not outside of the class itself, but it is optional. I'll be in the speech club, and eventually that will necessitate us to give these speeches.
Well, President Trott has said, if you want to come here.
You think you can come up here and give him?
I appreciate the offer. That's very kind.
we'll get with Mr. Theonis, and we'll set up a time and subject for you to come and speak to us about.
Do please.
Too easy, huh?
I'll give him my next board report.
Sure. Have him prepared for questions.
I'm about to sip and everything.
Okay. All right.
Next.
Right. Yep.
I'll do it.
Okay. So our next one is the Bob Harmon Service to Education.
All right. And so for this one, I would like to invite Maggie Evans up here. And as you can see, Maggie has been identified for the 2025 Bob Harmon Service to Education Award. And this is a national award. So one person a year is recognized for the Bob Harmon Service Education Award. And I am just absolutely so pleased to say it's Maggie. And I tell you, they picked the right person. When I read to you what the meaning of the award is, I think you're gonna then start to put the pieces together. But before I even do this, I wanna say that Maggie was nominated by somebody from OSPI. So it was somebody who saw the work that she was doing from afar and said, we need to recognize her. So she's not only making a difference here, but she's making a difference across the state and just with her continual input, which is what brought to this nomination, which was then actually being identified for the award. But the foundation of, or the purpose of the award says that it's to go to somebody who, I don't know if I can read my own writing, made a substantial contribution towards advancing the Elementary and Secondary Education Act. Purpose to provide all children with significant opportunities to receive a fair, equitable, and high-quality education to close educational achievement gaps. And I got to tell you, that's what this woman does day in and day out, and she holds us all accountable to it, and especially the part when it says all children. So it's not, you know, not just our kids who have all the supports at home, but our low-income students, which is a lot of the Title I work, which is where this award comes from, is Title I. But it's also, she's now working with Title VI, which is the Indian or Native American students, and she's starting a program there. She works with the ML students, which is another Title III service that she provides supports for. Along with that, she's started the dual language program. She works with our McKinney-Vento students. She works with our highly capable students, right? Another side of students. She does so much for all of our kids, and she's a huge advocate for them, making sure that we have the programs in place so that all of our kids are successful, making sure that the supports to support maybe some of the gaps that they have are in place, because everybody doesn't come to us ready to go, right? Some need a little bit extra support, and she finds a way to give the support to the kids that need it and that need extra support. You know, when we look at a student who's not quite reading right, how are we going to support those kiddos who are tier three? We've been talking a lot about our tier three, and a lot of those are our Title I students that need some of the additional supports. She's there, she makes it happen, and she's always thinking out of the box. So we're looking at things in different ways, which I think is why OSPI recognizes her, because it's not just the, okay, tell me what to do and I'll do it. She's one that's thinking, okay, we could do this and we could do it like this and it'll work a little better. And then other people are learning from her. So just wonderful work that she's doing. Let me see if I had anything else. I think the other RISE Center is something that she has put into place, which is supports for the families in our area, again, where there's an additional need. And the RISE Center is huge, sees a ton of kids. And Maggie doesn't do like daily work there, but she oversees our amazing ladies that are in the RISE Center and makes sure that they have the supports and resources that they need to be successful. I think the other thing that she does do that goes hand in hand with the title work is the LAP program, which is our state funds that work with a lot of our students who come to us with additional needs. But they picked the right person when they selected Maggie. She'll be going to the national conference in February, all expenses paid. And they're going to officially recognize her there in front of thousands of people who go to this conference. And but I'm telling you, they really did choose the right person when they selected Maggie. So Maggie, congratulations.
Thank you.
Yes.
Look back there and wave.
Oh,
say thanks, Mom.
Thanks. My mother and my sister.
Oh, cool. Very cool. We do want to get a picture.
Okay.
So we'll do it over in front of the flag again. And we definitely want it with our president and the rest of the board. If you know how to do it, you already lined up once.
You know where to stand.
Yes, you are.
Congratulations.
I was thinking about that one.
It wasn't me that
thank you. I was thinking about this before. I'm like, you're the only one that was there when you were
okay,
here.
Okay, so we're going to love it. Backwards, back.
Just hold your breath.
There we go. That's really great. That looks good. There we go.
There we go.
Can we please give Maggie a huge round of applause? Congratulations, Maggie.
Okay. We should have some cake or something. Jeez.
We always should have. You're right.
Like we're having all this celebration tonight. This is wonderful.
You didn't get the memo, you're supposed to bring it.
Yeah, you can't. If I would have known, I would have.
I was in Dairy Queen today.
I didn't get Costco. I got a big Costco cake.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Consent agenda. Okay. Do I have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Can I get a second?
Second.
Could I get any discussion? No discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? No opposed. So the motion has passed.
Damn.
Yes. Hey.
Okay.
Well. Who's going first?
All right. So the first thing on our report is soccer. We are really appreciative that last meeting you passed the motion to let middle schoolers play up. They've been playing on our JV team, making connections for with the players that they're going to be playing with next year. So they're having a lot of fun. They're doing really good on our JV. We won our second game versus Hopium 5-0 on October 10th. The varsity and JV played very well against our match yesterday versus Montesano. We played 100% throughout the whole game, even if the score didn't reflect it. I'm very proud of our players. Mr. Yurick said that these gals continue to make their presence known on the field and are currently sitting in fourth place in our league. They play again on Thursday versus Tenino, which is also our senior night. And if we finish in fourth place, they will play against a fifth place team of the Trico South, where the eighth spot in the district bracket. However, if we beat Tenino and Hopium, then we'll be in third going to the playoffs. So for our senior night tomorrow, it's at 7 p.m. It's versus Tenino again. Our seniors that we're recognizing are Piper Kornstrom, Taylor Staley, Mariana Alvarez, Estella, Kylie Cecina, Alondra Urub, and Kayla Black.
Football team, the last Friday beat Montesano for the first time in 20 years. And we played Tenino this Friday. And with a win against them, that'll be our first district title since the 1900s. And that's also our senior night. Or no, that's not our senior night. That's their senior night. And then the Friday after that is ours against Hopium. And our seniors are Cole Smith, Carson Rotter, Lucas McIntyre, Quinn Clevenger, Nicholas Mandiola, Conley Dolman, Brody Common, Ivan Castillo, and me. And the golf team, and Bowden Grimm's leading the average low, followed by Cash, Gavin Revel, Calvin Douthat, and Wesley Dahl. And they all got into districts and played yesterday at the day one District 4 1A golf districts. They didn't quite qualify for day two, but their spirits are high and they look forward to working together to get better between now and next year. None of those kids are seniors either, so better.
For volleyball, they're working hard as individuals and as a team to improve and compete. They've had some near misses in games, pushing sets to neck and neck, maximum, and just missing the one. They play this Thursday versus Tenino, which is also their senior night, and their last league contest at 7 p.m. They have 11 seniors this year, which are Arissa LeBaron, McKenna Vassar, Leah Hartley, Cheyenne Justice, Avelina, Somvalet. Thank you.
There you go.
Paxton White, Haley Boyd, Kylie Gailey, Katie Thompson, Sienna Harold, and Tati Cruz. And for swimming.
Yeah.
Okay. For swimming, our six seniors' last two outings will be on Tuesday, the 29th of October, at our home pool, Gorbex, in Centralia, and Wednesday, at the 30th, at the Grace Harbor YMCA in Aberdeen. The swim team has only lost a single dual meet all year and beat Aberdeen again yesterday. Casey Smith and Grace Morgan have earned automatic qualifying times for district and will compete on November 8th and the 9th, representing RHS. Coach Bringman notes that they are a tremendous team captains and will be missed from the program at the conclusion of their season. They had their senior night and celebrated Grace Morgan and Casey Smith.
Theirs is next week, Tuesday.
So the Fall Cheer team recently attended the UW Spirit Day at the University of Washington last Saturday. Had a great time. The seniors from cheer are Lily Hernandez, Paige Lawton, Karen Rivera, Allie Green, Fabiola Gomez. Mr. Rick says that they're all troopers and are bringing great spirit in all they do. They provide exceptional energy all year, especially in our win over Montesano last Friday. They have all battled the elements and keep on going. They truly provide spark in those moments where it can be hard to find.
And for cross country, in the men's, they have a better than average chance at league title, which hasn't been accomplished since 2013. The cross country has league championships tomorrow at Oak Ridge Golf Course in Elma at 5 p.m. They also have districts next week on October 31st with 11 runners, Gunnar Morgan, Hunter Young, Tatey Evanstar, Kian Christensen, Loden Coombs, Brendan Fontes, Zach Hubbard, Bruce Phillips, Jackson Reese, Mercedes DuPont, and Sarah Eldridge.
The FFA club had the state officers come and talk to their agriculture class and do some leadership workshops. They had a trip to the pumpkin patch this last Wednesday, where they went out in the Goodrich pumpkin patch, came back, carved pumpkins while having snacks and watching some Halloween movies.
For drama, they're having rehearsals every day after school for the play called Rebecca, and it's on November 22nd and 23rd.
Skills USA is preparing for their regionals anytime that they can. They're also getting the fundraiser plan for the trips to state and nationals, such as an Applebee's fundraiser and the wheel spinning fundraiser.
FBLA is fundraising by doing concessions at football games and also making banners for the sports teams and their senior athletes.
Trap shooting. And next Wednesday, Mr. Jeske is hosting the parent athlete meeting for trap shooting. So they haven't really got to start anything yet, but they will soon. And for band, four of the students at the high school were selected to participate in the PLU Honor Band, where students from all around the country get selected. And Karsten Moses, Jeremiah Jenkins, they're both seniors, and Hannah Johnson and Violet Wolf are both juniors. So that's what we got.
Excellent.
Questions?
Excellent. Question?
Mm-hmm. Very thorough.
Yeah.
Lots of stuff going on.
Right. Y'all don't want to hang out here with us, people from the 19, huh? You can leave.
Have a good evening, yeah. Guys. Thank you.
It's not too young, but it's really different.
Hey, Prince has a song by that. He's like, who's Prince? Okay.
Yeah.
You're up. You're the only one.
I know how to clear off the room. Don't turn around. Look. Do you have a PowerPoint up there? Oh, all right. Starting with heart. But before I start talking, I know some of you have seen our yearbook, but it's in my presentation. So there's 2 years of the yearbook. It's you'll see where that comes in play if you can look at what we got going on there. But so every year I get to present my heart report and my CTE report. So with the heart report, I have a new teacher this year from the middle school. Marissa Dozier has joined us. Ms. Thaden is retired from teaching. So we have a new teacher in Ms. Dozier, and she's fitting in exactly what we need at heart. So she's been a good fit. You know, it was a nice addition to heart. Last year we started without Charlie, and now this year she is been with us for the whole year, and it's really nice to have that EA support. It's our interventions. So celebrations, I want to always start with celebrations. So started school year with 32 students, and I have a slide coming pretty soon. It'll kind of give the breakdown of the last 7 years of where we started. So I'm happy with starting with 32. And then I wanted to highlight, we have three students enrolled in Running Start. And it's just, that tells me so much about the population I have. I have students that really want the college end of it, even though they're going to heart. They want to get the college credits, and I have three of them this year, so I'm really happy with it. The Fall Connection Conferences for heart is huge. I have intake with every student, every parent before the school year, so it's really, they're not really reapplying to go to heart. It's an intake meeting. So that time that's freed up before the school year really benefits heart and connecting with families. And they get to know the new rules, and we all sit down and we go over them together. So you'll see in my school improvement plan, there's a couple things that I'll address on that. So student attendance is trending up. I mean, I know that we're not that far into the school year, but I'm looking at that daily, and we're doing a percentage each day where we're at with students attending. So that is one of my school improvement plan areas is student attendance. So it is trending up, not a ton, but it's trending up. And in the yearbook that I passed around, we actually have officially one club, and that is the yearbook club. So students have to stay between the two sessions to be part of the club. And we only do it every 2 weeks. And it ramps, you know, February, we start meeting a little bit more, but they have to stay. So if you're an afternoon student, you come before your session to help out with the yearbook. And Charlie is playing a big role in it this year for me. And so we're rolling for new this year's yearbook. So those are the last 2 years. So that is one of the clubs, but I have another club that I want to start there that we'll get to. So there is our headcount and FTE for this year. So you'll see we have 2 months reported already. So you'll see how many freshmen, 0. For sophomores, you know, 12 juniors and 16 seniors. It's a good senior class. So you can see we're off and running at a good number. And that, you know, that other slide said we started with 32. We've already went up 2 this, you know, for October. So next slide talks about over time. I really thought it was important to show kind of time. You can go back to the 18-19 school year. You can see we had 25 students start the year, then 12, then the 20, then 8. Then, you know, I was able to, you guys let me go over to heart, which I still appreciate a lot. And we went from 29, 28, now 32. So trending in the right direction. It's not too big. It's a good number of students. So I'm happy with the trend where we're going with the headcount and FTE for heart.
Every year, you'll hear this in the CTE report too. I have to live my life by goals. I have to set goals because I like to have something I can achieve and I can have the school achieve. So through our school improvement process, we really look at, I want students to belong at Hart. I really want them to feel that they're part of it. That's one reason we do the yearbook, because we have, that's their school. We have pictures of them. Do we have an athletics center? No, we don't have athletics. Do we have a lot of clubs? No, but we have a little bit, and we do a lot of things around different celebrations. So that is all about relationships. So we're into building relationships because I wanted to feel this warm place where we can go and have our education. So that's why it's huge on that one bullet, or not really a bullet, but one statement, that graduation's at Hart. For those who have attended, you know, Ed's done a great job working all day. Jennifer came out with her husband to set up a tent, because we set up a big tent the day of graduation. It was an all-day thing. It felt like it really wasn't, but it was. Next year will be easier, because when we tore it down, it'll be a little easier to put it back together. But that's just another connection, because that's their school. They go to Hart, so we want to graduate out. The yearbook is another relationship building thing that we do on sense of belonging, is getting their picture in there and getting involved. So you'll see clubs, I have the yearbook club, but we're close to having our first STEM club. What we're looking at there is actually in 2 more weeks, on a Friday, some kids are coming in and we're going to do different activities. Our first one, we've already said, we're going to build a couple of the air water rockets, and we're going to go outside and work with those. We were talking about, they do the egg drop, they do these different things. I'm just trying to find a different way to connect with all kids at Hart. We have some kids that are really into the gears, and they really are into motors, and they're into different things, but they can see those 2-liter water bottles shooting up in the air and then do the work before on building it and guessing where it's going to go. We're just going to do different activities throughout the year, just once a month. We're going to start a little small, but we want to get this going. And I want more kids to attend on Friday. They don't have to right now, but in building this relationship with them belonging to the school, they come to school early. I have kids in my office at 7:10 in the morning. I'm trying to get my board report done tonight, but no, it's awesome. They love coming to school. So we're there and we're building relationships out. So that is about my goals. But now I get to do a school improvement. And today I was with Maggie on a Zoom, and I was telling them in the meeting, school improvement goals for me are great, because a lot of things we've figured things out at Hart, but it's really nice because we get to report those things and we have someone overlooking them, and I can bounce ideas. And I got to thank Maggie for everything she does to support Hart, because not only RISE, but she helps with so many things with Hart. So I appreciate her. Thanks she does there for that. But so goal one. Now, increase it. So before I started at Hart, we started doing a survey on how about Hart, how they like it and all this. Now I've changed the name a little bit to more belonging, but I'm still trying to use the questions I used 3 years ago, because over time, I want to see how that changes. I don't think it's data. I try to get the cleanest data. I know it's new kids, but I want to see if the data stays the same. So when it says we'll increase in each category, so we have different belonging questions, and the scale's really small. It's a 0 to 4 scale, but so we're looking to move up one scale on that. So we're getting the proficient, we want to be extinguished, but we're working on moving up one scale. So that's why it says we'll increase one category is the word up there. But we're doing that by our monthly celebration. So we celebrate attendance on track, completion of classes, and then we end up doing that with trivia games, having the students there. We have potluck, teachers will bring different things in, and just making it at the very end of their class day, they have a celebration, and the PM class, they get it at the beginning. So that's a couple activities, but I think the clubs will also have the sense of belonging and engagement at schools. That's number one. I'll give questions at the end. I know I'm going kind of through a lot of things I need to get through. Now this one's written kind of weird, but when you really look at it, we wanted a goal that we could dial into our chronic absent students. So that's where the 10%, that's defining that. So now once we define that, which I look at daily in my percentages, now I can go look at trying to improve that daily attendance. And so the chronic absences over time will hopefully be cut by the 10% is my goal. Last year, I didn't meet the goal, but this year we've put some new things in. We have our social-emotional lessons. We're doing attendance incentives that I already talked about with our celebrations, some home visits, trying to find those students, why they're not coming, what barriers they have, and then tiered intervention plans that I go over with them every 20 days if they're chronically. Goal three. So writing a goal, you know, we'd love to write a goal that says all kids will be on track all the time. So we wrote a goal around being on track now that you're at heart. So we're measuring it by a 6-credit day. So we want you, now you're a heart student, we're going to track that as being on track as a heart student, because sometimes the students come and they don't have, they're behind already. So that, if we wrote a goal around about having every student on track, we'd never get to on some of them because they come behind. So this one is dealing with heart students, and we're basing that on 6 credits if they're passing. So we do that different things, the one-on-one conferences, the check on the progress, the daily support to their academic work. So how that works, those this examples of that through the school improvement process a year ago, we came up with a daily goal sheet. So I ask every student, they stop by and they get a daily goal sheet that they fill out. It's real simple. I could have put a link on their identity, but it's really their name, the date, the time in and time out, what your goals are for a day, and did you accomplish those goals? And then on Friday, the teachers look at every one of those. We give feedback on Monday. They get a copy. And you know, it's the word copy because we keep one, because those come in handy in some of those conversations I have to have. I can pull out the, here's, well, Johnny is here at this time, leaves at this time. So let's talk about that. So it is a very simple thing that came through just the way we're trying to set goals for students, and we're still using it this year. And every, you know, you have to remind them, they know the routine, they go to desks, they get it, they sit down, they write it. And the second phase of that, I don't want to get too deep, I know my time is, but is now with teachers coming and going, because I start my day there, then the math teacher, English teacher, they come. Now they can look at the piece of paper and see what Johnny's working on. Instead of interrupting them, they might have earphones on because of the new program we have, there's videos. So it's just a quick check in, another check and connect. Then when I come back, I can look at it, look over their shoulder without interrupting them, and getting, seeing where they're at and if they're reaching their daily goal. So we get it right down to daily goal. So that's how we do for a goal three. And what then I just, some students in action, you'll see a couple of them, but in the yearbook, but the two on the sides are just students. So first day of school, that's why they have the finger up, say number one, first day of school, there. And it was, it's a fun bunch of kids. So any questions about heart report?
Did they go on half a day each?
Yes. So 3 hours, and there's an a.m. session, 3 hours, and a p.m. session that goes 3 hours.
Did you serve lunch then?
Yep. And breakfast. Hot breakfast and hot lunch.
Okay. And is there an expectation that they do work outside of
class? Yes. And there's 2 hours. The contract they sign is a 2 hours every day that they have to spend doing homework. So they should be, their goal is 28 hours in a week. And this new program that we have does a great job of tracking idle time and how much time you're actually taking a quiz, how much you're reading. I mean, it breaks it down. It makes my some of my conversations very easy with parents.
So can they stay there the whole day if they want to?
Yes, right now I have a student that does it right now because he doesn't have internet at home, and he's that focused. Sometimes if you ever come over, I'll give him a longer break sometimes. Since he starts at 7:15, he'll sit outside the Boys and Girls Club and just take a little extra break. So
yes. A couple of questions. I hope I haven't asked you in the past, but it came to me. One is, do these students pay like their student body fees and stuff like all students do?
They can pay, yes.
They do that. I see that you talk about the belonging and the school and heart And some of the rewards are like the Rochester mugs and stuff with the R on it and stuff like that. Do they have, do you have?
Well, we made our
art mugs and art.
Yeah, we have our own t-shirts or okay. Our own logo that we created.
Yeah, that's what. Okay, yeah. Thanks.
We got to see one of the graduations.
Oh, yeah. Both of those graduations are amazing.
Yeah.
I went last year.
I seen the three students are enrolled in Running Start. Are they afternoon students or are they morning students that are
actually two in the morning, one in the afternoon?
Oh. How does that work? Do they come partly to you then to Running Start?
Yeah. Okay. And some of them are doing this to the again, some students come a little behind the credit. They're making up credits as they go. So it's grab some credits.
So are they actually trying to get ahead of where their school?
One student's interest is something the college offers that I can offer, and he really wanted to go down that industry, so he's going to Running Start.
Nice, very good, very cool.
Yeah,
like it.
All right, you hit me again. So let's switch here. I ground myself, CT.
By the way, Kev, just your energy and your enthusiasm for the work out there. That's wanted to hear you talk.
Thank you. No, it's fun work. And I'm blessed because now I get to talk about CTE, and I wish I could talk about athletic, but that's all right there. All right, so tonight, actually, I started my evening. Well, I started, you know, I had a meeting with Maggie, but then I had my advisory meeting tonight at the high school. I started at 5 and they're probably finishing up now. So, you know, twice a year we have advisory where each CT department brings in industry people and we go over different things about each program, and they meet with their teachers and they go over different industry standards. But that's going on tonight. But I just want to put a slide together that, you know, CT off provides a ton of things to our students. You know, I'm always looking for career opportunities, ways to explore different careers that are out there. 2 years ago, we bought a program called U Science and does a great job of doing industry standards for us, but also a lot of career guidance around there. And since I bought it at the high school, I asked Maggie and she bought it at Hart for us. So I guess I'm back and jumping back to Hart, but I use that at Hart for career. So students can explore different careers, and we do it, you know, I do it at both schools, and so it's a great program that can give industry standards there also. So another thing it provides, and you'll see coming up, but dual credit opportunities, it connects students with good paying entry-level jobs is our goal, and then just real world, working in the real world, and the teachers teaching in a way that it's about industry, and this is what industry standards are, and that's what tonight's meeting about, is to get in industry people there to give feedback to our teachers to make sure that we're not missing anything that's new out there in industry. Employability skills, we're always working with that in every class we have, because as kids need those skills when they get out in the workforce. And then develop leadership skills. There's a CTSO that I'll talk about, which is their student organizations that will be coming up, but that's where the leadership skills come in, and it provides a pathway to apprenticeships, industry certifications, 2-year and 4-year options through CT. So the next one, just like Hart, you know, I need to set goals for myself where I wanted this program, where I wanted to see this program go 3 years ago when I took it over, but there's a lot there, and I'm working on all of them. Just like any goal, we're always trying to tweak them. So, you know, explore opportunities. I want kids to explore. And I'm not, some of these are on the first slide, so I don't want to repeat myself too much, but the industry certification through U Science, we're getting some certifications, you know, OSHA 10, every student's in OSHA classes getting that. So that when they go out in the real world, they have the first step of their OSHA part already taken care of through school is one example, to their food handler's card, to different things that in high school, so they're ready for a job. You know, link to post-secondary education and try to find those good entry-level jobs for them. So that ties back into our U Science that we're using. And obviously, we want them to be good employees, so employability skills with the job-related skills. So we always around industry, what industry's doing and partnering with the industry so we know what's happening. You know, so then I talk up and you'll see some slides coming up, but participate in the career and technical student organizations. You'll hear that a lot referred to as CTSOs. And that's the slides will explain. I won't go into now, but I'll go into that. Then participating in skills, competitions, community service. Every CTSO last year participated at state. They went to state. Obviously, you know, we have, you know, on from state, we had some nationals. We got second place, you know, with our drones and our search and rescue, but every CTSO participated in state, which is a first for Rochester, I believe. I mean, it's been a long time. Justin could correct me, but so, and then become leaders, participating. That's the biggest thing out of that I really want them to do. And then rigorous program of study. I want it to be rigorous. I want to challenge the students. So each person is being challenged. So if we went back to, you know, when I talk about goals, so if we go back just 2 years in time, I think we had one class with agreement with the college to get credit. With the help of Justin and my teachers, we were able to get 24 credits now. Just going to our high school, getting a dual credit with the college on the side there, and how many credits now they can get by just taking our intro to medical careers class, they can get a 5-credit from Centralia College for that class. Same with animal bio. Now, we went reached out to Walla Walla, and that's where we pulled that. So they're going to give us, so on a transcript, it will show a 5-credit from that different college. It's on the side. So I'm not done expanding that. I mean, we have a list on Justin's wall. We're still hammering at the amount of, but we're going to keep working it. We're going to grow that even more. My intention. All right. So then I wanted to throw out some FTEs. We talked about FTEs because that's a huge thing because that's where we get our money. Everybody talks about money, but I want to show you over time in the 3 years. So that's not 97 students in that are doing that. That's six. To get that number, that's 6 periods a day students are taking to equal 1 full-time student. You have to be in 6 classes. So we're claiming 138 FTEs this year out of CTE.
837 students. We only have 620 in the high school. So we have students taking more than one CTE course currently.
So you'll see where that number's grown, and it's by the work of business and marketing. We're doing some things around there. We can expand there. We have different things we can do. So we're going to grow. I'm not done at that number. I'm just wanting to show you over time where we're. And that's a lot of students taking a CTE class at Rochester High School. So I kind of talked about CTSOs earlier, but and that's where you'll hear those words around Skills USA, the FFA organization, FBLA, and the sports medicine one. So all those we went to state last year and competed at state. So that FBLA was a first time ever, you know, they've done, well, not, I can't say ever, because in a short period of time.
Since the 1900s.
Yeah. Words out of my mouth.
Did we do this in the 1900s?
So anyway, those are different student organizations that you'll hear me talk about throughout the presentation. So, and in the different classes. So let's see the next one. And I, you know, different programs under ag, those are different classes we offer. And then in the next slide, we'll show some kids working. So ag chemistry class and FFA officers working at different things. So I think the kids talked about the pumpkin patch, where there's their picture of them at the pumpkin patch, showing a chicken and a duck down there at the fair, different things that they're involved with. So that's the ag chemistry class and using the CTSO FFA. And then some students working in the shop. So Michael tonight with the group that we had in there, he did a demonstration of the new CNC machine. Again, it seems like, please email Dr. Bethman or myself. I'd love to get you guys in there, get a walkthrough. Let's see the good things we're doing. See the business marketing, see them all. I'd love to somehow get, you know, I'll get you a tour. I love to see that CNC machine's awesome tonight. He pre-programmed a few things and they cut it right there on the spot for the visitors that were there. They got to see it in action. So then next one, then Mr. Jeske does those different things through Skills USA. So it's just not one it's a one organization that has lots of different competitions. It's welding, welding fab, his art, sculpture, piece of welding, and then his power equipment technology. He really, the reason cabinet making's on the bottom, he's really exploring that one this year. He has a volunteer that has been in the wood shop for 3 to 4 years now, and he's a great one. He's a local and just he volunteers every day, and he has that skill set to help those kids and those just thinking, just putting a birdhouse together. We're going to do some cabinet making. He's an asset. So then health sciences, you know, you'll on that one slide earlier on, that health is a new thing that we got dual credit just this year with Centralia College. It's ink is still wet. We just signed the agreement. So that is a great opportunity for kids to get a credit through Centralia. Then intro to medical careers was done last year, dual credit with Centralia College. And then obviously we have sports medicine and next year, we're looking to get advanced spreadsheets.
I gotta say something on this slide. So we need to understand about that health credit. Every freshman that gets an A or B in health will get 3 credits at Centralia.
That's awesome.
That gets an A or B in health class will get 3 credits at Centralia.
Start out their high school.
Thanks to Kevin working the articulation agreements. Yes. So we get to start their college collection of college credits and maybe work on trying to hold, because that's part of Kevin's goal is, right? Let's see how many credits we can get kids and keep kids here. Not send them down to Ready Start, but keep kids here, right? And so we're starting that as a freshman. And that was a big, big get. That's
we got some more to get.
That was a big get. So.
All right. And then she put some pictures in of kids working. She wanted to make sure we see kids working on athletes. Next slide would be ASL. You know, we're thrilled to announce we have a new teacher, Dean Roberts. He comes to us with a huge background in signing. He was in a local college for a number of years and just fell on our lap, and he was available to come teach our Rochester. So really happy to have him. He has a passion for teaching and dedication of ASL. It's there are in it when they walk in the door because he is totally deaf. So it's all signed. It's game on, and it's you can see the growth though if you go in there and see the kids have to sign, and it is awesome the growth that we're seeing. Business Ed, those are courses that are available. Obviously, we have a new program there we're working through. Really looking at trying to start a student store. I think it might be on the slide coming up, so I might be jumping ahead of myself, but the new teacher is looking at a student store that we ran during lunchtime. So students have an opportunity. They're working on a business plan now. This is a slow rollout. We're looking for second semester to do this because we're trying to do it right. Instead of just telling the kids what to do, we're trying to have the kids tell us how to run it. So they're making a business plan and developing it as we go. But I might have jumped a little bit ahead because it's on another slide. But maybe next one. But in her class, she's taking advantage of the machines that we have purchased over time. And she did the Warrior Pride card that you'll see at the high school there. She did that in-house. She's doing science for concession. She has lots of people helping her, and we are trying to not to overwhelm her with things too, because she is a yes person. She is going, she will do it for us, but I'm making sure that she does enough to do everything that is put on her plate. So, and then fundraising, she is trying to fundraise like crazy. You'll see on November 1st, she's taken 23 students to Grace Harbor for the fall FBLA leadership conference, which I think that's brand new for Rochester to take kids to. So that's not state yet, but I know she'll be doing state in the spring, but we have to start somewhere. So she is building a program as we go, participating in, you know, they But really doing the fundraising, her first bullet she put on there, she's fundraising a lot because she needs to pull this off the store and everything she needs to support. Kids talked about the banners. You can see students working on the banners there, right there in that picture. And she's very knowledgeable of the Roland machine that you guys approved a couple of years ago. It was very expensive, so we're getting good use of it. She knows it. I actually just sent her yesterday to Hanson where we bought the Roland machine to get her trained because she needs to be trained and use it. She came with training, but she needed to know our machine. So she's giving her the support so we can have, she can run a great store off. Stammen is obviously falls under engineering, robotics, search and rescue, AEP, physics, and American Sign Language is actually under the skilled and technical science piece of it. But with Mr. Coos, next slide, he has, I asked him for some pictures and he put some pictures together and he's got like three sets of pictures, but this is how awesome he is. Not one of them talks about finishing second at nationals. That's what the outcome is. But you know, it's awesome he did that, but he shows kids working on things. They did the homecoming results for by the robotics team drives the crown to the game. So that's a crown in that robotics. So really involved with the students at Rochester. And so
picture held up.
No, but again, they're not a, I mean, he's very proud of finishing second last year. That's all great. I mean, and being a national champ a couple years ago, but I just felt it was really cool that he put pictures of kids doing what they're doing now because we're, you know, that's awesome, but we're moving on. We're going to go get another one. So that probably gave a lot of, any questions? That was a lot of talking. I should have brought a water.
Should have gotten one, sorry.
I have one.
No.
So in my high school, not just from my high school I graduated from, but in Alabama, they have, it's a shipbuilding town. Mobile is a shipbuilding town.
Yeah.
Okay. And there is a couple of different places, but one of the places that I see online a lot is a place called Huntington Ingalls, some H-I-I, but they're Huntington Ingalls and they're shipbuilders.
Okay.
And they have an apprenticeship program. And while I was searching for stuff one day, they have something up here. And then I lost it and I couldn't find it anymore.
I can re-Google that.
And I don't remember how my search went. But the point is that I want to see something about that. I mean, these kids, when they graduate that program, they can go into whatever fields that they have. And that is a good career opportunity.
And then with, you know, Newmark is doing some things with the port. They're doing, is it marine?
Yep, so.
Marine diesel at the port that Mr. Escher was able to get a program there. So they're starting some programs around it. So that's a good deal.
Obviously, they wouldn't be able to stay here to do that.
Right.
But still, that's a good opportunity. And I actually emailed them and they never emailed back. So that was, you know. So, but that was my question for that.
Yeah, I think you reaching out to the port and working with Mr. Isler because we're still close and just trying to find his contacts.
Okay. All right. Any other questions?
I have a couple comments and questions. One, I'm glad you brought up that machine because I remember getting the machine.
Yeah.
I thought the vision of that was, maybe that's what you're saying, is that it, eventually, the kids might actually make the money because then community groups and stuff coming in for signs made and stuff like that. Is that still kind of the vision?
That's the end goal right now. Just the overwhelming of getting a good product out there and getting the kids trained because I can't to have one teacher do that. It's going to be a
so it's kind of falling on one teacher at this point,
right? To do because it's a, you know, it's an entailed machine to use, so kids are learning how to use the machine. So yes, that
okay.
is So still goal, they did stuff for Sweet Day and they've done.
Oh, did they? They've made stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
The signs for the cars.
Yeah.
The parking here signs.
Yeah. And it looks like they make that senior poster. I didn't realize.
Yep. Yeah, they've been doing those.
I would say the high school staff is keeping them busy.
Just for the stuff that they need.
Just for the stuff that.
Yeah.
Yes.
But I saw the fundraiser that they had. Oh,
right.
Yeah.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
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 Right now.
They'll get there.
Yeah.
They'll get there. Yeah.
And then the other is, I haven't been out there yet to the what was the farm, but I hear that the animal sciences thing or something may not be running this year. Is that true, or do they still have all the critters out there and still doing that?
No, animal? There's just a couple critters out there, isn't there, Justin? Just
maybe.
That's different than what it was. I mean, it was a big operation. So are we still doing animal science?
Not like that. I would do more to bio, ag bio and biology.
Well, I must have missed it. Why the change?
Just interest in the class and the numbers of students to run a full class. Over time, it was a produce enough students to
really
make it feasible.
So we don't have our own chickens to lay our eggs and
we
cows
or pigs, nope. Pigs to slaughter. I don't.
No.
Well, that could be a good conversation for.
We would like to see that, but we have not had the kids registering for it.
So it's still on the books to run. It's just interest in getting that back up.
Was it this year that it stopped then, or was it 2 years?
There was a class last year.
Yeah. So it's been slow. The numbers have been going.
Bindling.
Yeah, for a few years.
Okay. Is there no ag science or
the ag, science.
The ag, right. Ag animal? There's no.
Not the ag. Not
this year. Okay.
Thanks.
Yeah.
We're done. Steve, you don't have anything? Okay.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for
watching. Thank you, Kevin.
Yeah. Ed, you're up.
Last one, so I could read my own writing. So I'm just going to give you this report by each school. We'll start at RPS and just go all the way up to the high school.
Slide,
there you go. So RPS, one of the main things we're doing right now is that picture on the right is our X-therm boiler. We're in the process of going through that. We're going to do a full service on that. When I say we're having an elite mechanic who come in and do it. And then Justin Knutson, our new HVAC guy, is going to work closely with him. It's a great training process for him. To go through that. He's quite excited about going through that because we have that same boiler at middle school. The boiler on the left is the backup boiler. So when we tear the X-therm down, that the blue boiler on the left will automatically kick in. That's the old style, but it has big cast plates and everything in it. It's still fully operational. The middle school has these exact identical boilers, the X-therm that they run on, and then the blue cast iron plate boiler. But it is the one at the middle school is the one that is failing. It'll run, but it leaks water. It leaks the coolant, the additive that we put in the water. So I'll make this little elaborate on boilers for all the schools on this pitch right here is that the high school, we have one boiler. It's half the size of that exotherm. And I believe it is the original boiler from the school when the school was installed. We're 100% on borrowed time on that boiler. The elementary school is a one boiler setup school as well. So middle school and RPS are the only ones that have backup boilers. And of course, they're the newest schools that we have. So we do have receiving quotes out for new boilers. We're in the process of with the whole Clean Buildings Act, deciding whether we can go stay with gas or have to go electric with the Clean Buildings Act. So it's a bit of a challenge there. Switch over to electric is substantially more expensive. Anyway, so that should be about a week process, and then we could be back to the X-therm boiler. So the sports field, the picture on your right is a sports field at RPS. We're doing our due diligence to try to get that field into shape. When I say in shape, it looks good there in the picture, but you literally have to put a seatbelt on the mower to keep yourself in the saddle when you're mowing it because it is so rough. So that's going to require getting rollers and putting soil and all that. And the reason we want to put, try to put as much effort in that, one, for the kids at the school, but two, we're in so demand for sports fields, we're going to be needing to use that for something, for, you know, JV soccer, girls soccer, whatever it is, we need to utilize that space. We just don't have enough space for it. It's a challenge with our manpower and the resources that we have, but it's a goal that we have set. The pictures on the left are the playground at RPS, which during the wintertime used to be what they called their little pond. This here recently, we finished up the project. We completely went through the playground and put in a French drain style drain system that goes into the gutter system, goes into the dry well that's just north of the playground. So no longer we should have water ponds in there so kids can play when it's a rainy day and not have to have three teachers out there to keep kids out of the pond. So it's just another one of the drainage projects we've worked on that everybody's excited to finally have done.
And it's working.
And it's working. Yeah. And it was all done in-house. So BMES, we have some siding replacement going on portables. And when I say going on, it's literally, they called me this morning, says, Ed, we got a window, we can come out. So, you know, luckily working with Kelsey and the teacher, they're fine with putting up with a little bit of hammer and banging on the side of the portable. And it's actually all the old siding is stripped off and they're going to start resheathing tomorrow and everything. we have a lot of portables that don't have this much damage, but they have some siding damage, not enough to get in there and replace it all yet, but enough that it's still solid enough that it's keeping the weather out. But it's just the nature of the portables with that siding that it just isn't very durable. You know, it's just
their life. Damage behind it or just pretty much?
No, just the end, that's the main weather side. And this is the side where this location, this portable is 27, is where all the parent drop off and pickup come in. They come through, there's gates right there to the left of that picture on the left. There's double gates right there and that's where they all drive in, so. Our parents will get a good dose of seeing what's happening, what we're doing to maintain our assets right now. So,
you have to do the whole building or just?
Just this end, the entire end. And it also has an air conditioning unit on it. So we're working around that air conditioning unit, that panel box, all that stuff had to get removed. You know, again, another one of those things, nice to have an in-house electrician like we did with David Deal, because we can do all that stuff. You know, you bring somebody else in and it's, you know, $300 more. So, RMS, we have portable siding issues there. The picture's on the right. If you look up that first picture, you can see just all the nails are just popping right out. The weather with the heat on the back of that building and it gets cold at night, it just sits there and expands and contracts. And literally almost every sheet down the back of all three of those portables, the nails are coming out like that. So.
Need screws.
We got to get in there and, you know, resecure those. Of course, you know, those holes ain't going to work. So we got to, you know, get in and do no new and caulk and paint. It's just a never ending process. We have some sheathing on the main building as well that is coming loose. They had some before I came. That was the same situation. They had to get up there and screw it in. And we're getting some of that on that building as well. Same with the siding. It's, you know, we're getting a building that's, you know, 20 plus years old. So.
Good. Next slide.
Yeah, next. Oh, no, actually, the pictures on the left are a swing set that we're putting in for the SPED department there. And that's a project that we're doing all the labor and everything on it, but the Chehalis tribe is paying for all the materials and everything. So that's going to consist of, it'll have footing in there, playground, EWF, that engineered wood fiber, the same as the playgrounds, and it'll have a swing set in there. That's all that's labeled to be in there right now. Possibly in the future, there might be a picnic table around the corner or something that teachers are excited about seeing what's going on. They just find advantages for that. So who knows, we're just prepping for whatever might come down the road. That should have a fence around it and curbing, so it'll all blend in with the lawn and it'll look like it's been there from original. So before I leave the middle school, the walking track that's in, everybody's been given, I have a picture of it, but people have been just given horrendous feedback about that track, because before they were walking in the mud and the wet grass. And I even had somebody approach me out here the other day asking if they could use that track at the middle school, go walk at the middle school on the weekends. I said, yeah, the gates open. just because they just like that track that's right there. So
that's when you're getting feedback is middle
school. Yeah, the middle school people. I mean, they love the elementary school one too, but they've always had the gravel track, you know, since I came. But the middle school, that paved track is a big deal. They like it. Teachers like it. Students like it. I had somebody to pick up stop me the other day and says, hey, start talking about that track from Adam. On the weekend, by all means, you know, use it, and after hours, you know.
Is the ground over the field over at the primary school big enough to have a track around it?
It does have track around it. That was the first track that we put in. Yeah,
at the primary school?
Yep. Yeah. Every school has a paved track.
Yeah.
That was all done with grant funds.
Yeah. Except for the high school doesn't have a paved track, but you know, we have the actual regular track, and then we have the cross. Actually, that picture on the left of the high school, that is the actual cross country track that we put that goes out throughout the 80 plus acres. That it's roughed in pretty much, mostly has footing. This is one of the cleanest sections right there. But the cross country is using it, and my hope is that soon Davina and her walking class will start using that. The more people use it, the easier it is to maintain. The pictures on the right are, that's Gunnar Morgan's exercise project that's along the Promise Carper Trail. Nice little chin-up bars, hang from your knee bars, whatever it is that somebody wants to do to stretch out when you're running and doing whatever. I've had a few people ask about it when it was under construction, but now it's completed. Sorry,
Gunnar. I think the middle picture has some dip bars in there.
Yeah, it's chin-up bars, all kinds of different bars.
Or if you're short, chin-up bars.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. People who are vertically challenged.
Yeah.
Had a couple of questions. Is cross country the practice here? But have they hosted a meet?
They actually have. They've actually used that trail on cross country. Yeah,
cool.
And they're pretty excited about it.
And the other one, back to the primary Thomas Park. I was with it the other day, and first of all, you guys do a great job. But those stenciled things that are on the playgrounds, on the the pavement, where they have pictures and the kids play on it. So how often do you have to repaint those?
Well, I mean, it'd be great if we could repaint them every year, but we just don't have the manpower to do that.
Yeah.
We actually had, that's one of the things we typically have, that when we hire that two high school students in the summer, that's one of the projects that we have them help with. But this year we had-
They're really cool.
We had them involved in so many other things, and the kids love them. Especially the primary school, that big circle and all the numbers and the little speed track and all that, it'd be nice to repaint them every year. We just didn't have the resources this year to do it.
So you could use it every year.
Oh yeah,
you try to get there
for sure.
Always taking retired state workers.
I know. I'm thinking I do it now, though. Not doing it next year. I'm actually a man short right now because I had one that resigned, chose another career opportunity.
Opportunity.
Oh, there you go.
Got to have
in
your retirement.
No, it looks really good too when it makes everything look newer. You know, you got it all painted up and everything. So people
still like
it. So RHS, I'll show these. This is the football field. This is just how much use our field is getting. We look at this. We have one more football game to go on here, but we have a soccer game that goes on here tomorrow. And the picture on your left, all that mud strip you see right there, the soccer field line goes right down the middle of that. This is just how much use our sports fields are getting all the time. With the use that we're putting on them, this is just what happens to them. And like this right here, I have no way to correct this until the spring. It's only going to be like this or get worse just because of the rain, because nothing's going to grow. There's nothing you can do to make that grow. And springtime's too close to when sports start. So just about the time we get it lushed up, then everything's on it again. It's just the challenge that we face all the time with this. Our practice field this year has looked better than it ever has. I mean, it's greener and getting more lush, but it's just, we just use our sports fields a lot. It's just it's a huge challenge that we have.
So what are the plans going to be? Are we going to get some cut sod and put down?
We did that last year, and we spent a couple $1,000s on cut sod. But every place that you put that in, that union just doesn't want to grow grass. You could grow the grass that you put in there, but the union just doesn't want to. We still got, you can see where every piece of sod that we place is in that field. Just a challenge, you know.
So what does the WIAA say about this type of environment? Does that mean we need to play games away from Rochester?
Well, if the referees call it and say the field's too muddy, then we, that's exactly what we do. We play at another school. We'll play football at Tenino or some other place that has a turf field.
Okay. And how many? We got one more football field?
We have one more game? Football game. We have another soccer game tomorrow. One more home game. Yeah. But then you're not talking, you know, get the Pee Wee football and soccer and all that stuff that goes on. It just really.
And we have the middle school field that we could also use, or that's what we're working on
as well. Okay. But we can't do any night games or anything like that because we have no lights up. Same as the primary field that we're trying to get in shape. We don't have any lights there. So there's no nighttime.
With more like JV games, weekend day games. Okay. Yeah, because it looks rough. Mm-hmm. I said it was the last football game. It was raining sideways and all that on a Friday night. I'm like, I need to go there. But I'm like, we're run the ball.
Well, like this right now, I mean, one of the things we have, I bought a paint sprayer four or five years ago when I came here. To do all of our own painting and stuff. We have a backup sprayer that we have. Unfortunately, Thursday's football or Friday's football game, halfway through the day, the paint sprayer, our main paint sprayer, gave up the ghost, said, I don't want to work anymore. So we got the backup sprayer and it decided it didn't want to work either. Pumps all the paint out of the pump. So I NASCAR'd both of those to Tacoma, but we actually finished painting the football field with trays and rollers, numbers and hash marks and everything. That's how that football field is painted. And depending on what they say when I call them first thing tomorrow morning, we will be painting the soccer field the same way for tomorrow's game. It's just, you know, yeah. So some of those things we can get, you know, make a trip to Uline and get the upside down paint and the walk behind sprayer wand, but that's the way it has to be done with these fields. We painted the middle school, I don't know, 3 or 4 weeks ago, and is when I was one man short, and Owen Pratt was there, and I was there, and we're painting it. This game started at 4:30, and we were literally painting it at 4:25. And we're listening to all the parents from the other schools saying, I can't believe they have to mow this and paint this every time we do a game here, because they're also used to playing on turf fields that are prepped elsewhere, you know? And they're like, I can't believe you paint this every time. You know, you can hear, they're not talking to us, you can hear them talking amongst themselves. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just like, it's just reality, it's what it is.
Something that used to be done in the 1900s.
I know. The problem is we have a lot of kids here. We have a lot of kids and a lot of activities doing a lot of stuff. Mm-hmm. They're all doing it on the same grass. That's the problem.
Can we utilize this field here or anything?
Yeah, this field is so rough. Little League does. The summer Little League occupies this to try to get off the other ones.
On baseball. Yeah,
they come and do.
And they come and maintain it and put dirt, and they've done all that, yeah. Just because all the other fields are used so much, you know. We are in the process. We have the JV fast pitch field that we put in by the maintenance field. We're actually starting on putting the concrete forms down and trying to get the concrete poured before it freezes so that we can work on building the dugouts so they can have that. They want to play games there in the worst way next year. So
which field?
The field that we put in by the maintenance shop. We put in a JV fast pitch field there by the maintenance shop.
Oh,
yeah.
Cool.
That's right. I got puddings and bases and all that. And they practiced there all last year, but they want, you know, we got to get the fence up and the dugout so they don't have fly balls come at them, stuff like that. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
That's just, so let's see what else I had here. We are doing some scheduled maintenance on the water reservoir right now. That consists of exercising valves, sealing cracks, flushing lines and hydrants. We're right at the end of irrigation season, so shutting that water off is the time to go through these and exercise that stuff. Just help us stay ahead of making sure valves are doing what they're supposed to be doing when we need them. HVAC, we lost a unit above the gym. We rebuilt that, and then shortly after got that rebuilt, we lost another one of the units above the gym. It's still heating, but it's not air conditioning. And so we're running it the way that it is. It's doing the heating. We don't have all units going full blast on air conditioning, and we should be able to manage through this for a while.
Question, did we get any sort of stuff from the COVID funding for the AC, the HVAC systems for upgrades?
Not that I know of.
I mean,
we had ESSER funds and we could have put them towards updates on the HVAC system. I don't think any were used in the district for HVAC upgrades. There might have been some filters.
I think there's some portable filter units and stuff like that it was used for.
For the portables.
Right.
Yeah.
A lot of the a lot of that HVAC stuff was on the fence with COVID. Are you removing more air? Is it good or are you circulating more? You know, I mean, that was the dance that happened with a lot of that. There was no precise, this was the best way to go. So,
I know that you were doing all efforts were being made to upgrade, get better airflow.
Yeah. And like the HEP 13 filters and stuff like that. But then they found that those filters are so much more restricted. They filtered so much more, but then they put so much more burden and wear and tear on your unit. So, like I said,
that's why I thought
it's one half a dozen of the other. Yeah.
We're replacing the whole unit assembly.
Okay.
Our systems were not as archaic as a lot of other districts, and therefore, much of our issue was around programming and making sure that you.
Computer aspect.
Yes.
And then just another, since we've last met, the last school board meeting, we replaced two more 3-inch pipes that are irrigation system. It's just the balance. Every time we fix one, it puts more pressure in another spot and just makes that leak come that much more. So someday I hope that we'll get on top of it and maybe we will stop them all, you know.
You're going to replace it all section by
section. Pieces at a time, literally. I mean, literally, piece at a time. Yeah, literally the guys fix the one in the baseball field and they're like, yes. And the very next day they went out to the baseball field and the grass was mounted up about 4 feet high. It's like, no, that was the second one. Because whatever we did there made that one being all the leak went there. You know, instead of it being in three, now it's down to one. And it's just the challenge.
Yeah.
Questions?
The Rochester Middle School. The swing stuff with the sped money, that was the cards we signed today for the Chehalis tribe, correct?
Yes.
We had taken that donation. How did we get involved with that? Or what aspect did we bring the Chehalis tribe in to help fund this? Or how did that work?
It's actually a Chehalis tribal student that we serve here, and he needed some additional supports. Okay. He has a swing that he uses, he had a swing at Grand Mound that he used all the time as part of his therapy when, you know. And so now they really felt like having that same structure at the middle school would help them. And so that's what we're putting in. That's what we decided to put in there. And the Chehalis tribe said they would support that and pay for it.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Very wonderful. And, you know, it's important to have these connections with the local tribe. And this is a wonderful opportunity to show how this can work together.
Yep. And they were very willing to work with us and wanted to make it happen. So it was really nice, like you said.
Wonderful.
Together on that one.
The site's all prepped. We're waiting for the components to come in.
Nice. Well, hopefully we can do some more collaborative efforts with them. Moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely. Much appreciated.
Anybody else? Anybody else?
Nope.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Business.
All right. So Jill is out ill this evening. Yep. But you did see she's got her kids working for her. So that's what. But Justin, if you can click that.
Yep.
Slide there. Thank you. So just, we only have an enrollment summary tonight. Jill is working on the year-end budget. We've had some challenges with our new queue system, so we don't have any of that data for you right now. You will have an update at the March meeting. At least that's what we're hoping it all works for by then. November. Yeah, by March, you'll know it all. In November, November 6th. This is our student enrollment report. And
grass and spring.
Yeah. I'm just going to fast forward the clock. student enrollment, you can see where we are. 2662 is our FTE. So that's a 2062 student FTEs. For our headcount, we're 2,118 for October. The 2,062 is 23 students above where we were last year at this time. So we are seeing more students. It's also important to note here that we're almost 19.89 students above what we budgeted to be at. So we did budget conservatively. We definitely want to see, we don't want to come in under our budget. So we're where we need to be there. You can see our running start student enrollment there. It's about the same as it was last year. And then you see HEART students, which Kevin shared that data with you. And then you can see the SPED report. And our special education numbers are a little bit higher than they were last year. And you can see they're a little bit higher in October than they were in September. Part of that is because as we get new students into our system, we end up qualifying more students as we see the needs. And then Gravity is the ESD program that we have some students at. And I think we had 5 for the most part last year, and right now we have 6 at Gravity. So the next slide there is the graph, and you can see where we are relative to other years. And we are a little bit higher than we have been for the past 3 years. Yes, for the past 3 years. And like I said, we are 23 students above, 23 FTE above where we were last year. We are only 12 students above. So our FTE is, there's much a lot more difference between our FTE last year at this time and the compared to FTE last October. But our student headcount is actually only 12 students different. Regardless, we're higher than we were. Continue to grow. All right, and then my report for you. Just have a few things. Oh, yep.
Real quick on the enrollment. I'm just noticing a couple of things.
Uh-huh.
Kindergarten.
Small.
Small.
Yeah. We're not sure why.
Not sure why. Yeah.
Yeah, we don't know why. We did add a teacher finally because we had the funding from the class size reduction for K-3 class size reduction. So we did have the money to do it, but our kindergarten is smaller than it has been for previous years.
I'm just thinking planning wise, you get that class at that size and you got the 191 or whatever.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A lot of shifting of personnel on that.
A lot of shifting of personnel, a lot of changing, you know, as we move through the system. And is that an indicator of what's to come, right? Is that the beginning of a new trend or is that just an outlier?
Yeah.
And it's so hard to know with kindergarten.
Yeah.
And Maggie, right now, we're not seeing any increase in our partners in the enrollment in daycares.
No. They are, they're full, which is an indication that we always like them full. That means that they're going to hopefully come to us. That's a little bit deceiving because Roots is going through that transition. Mm-hmm. So that's going to be a question mark in the next couple of months. But early learning is looking typical. So that, you know, with it, you know, yeah. I don't think we're going to go down below 100. I think it's COVID personally. Yeah, that's what I think. But, so I think in a few years,
5-year-olds are showing up.
Yeah.
We'll be back up.
Well, the first grade 150. So, I mean,
yeah.
You know, it's,
yeah, well, I was trying to, when would these kids have been born? 2020? Maybe it's back.
19.
Right before.
Okay, never mind. I don't know.
All right. Any other questions?
No one question? All right. New business.
Actually, we have a few slides for me. I'll go really fast. How's that?
Oh, I thought you...
I have just a few things.
Oh, sorry. I thought you were.
I know. I wasn't that fast. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. I'm like, oh.
So we did just get done with conferences. We did our success conferences in August. And then this is the first conference where teachers sat down and really had conversation with our families about how kids were doing academically. You can see really good attendance at RPS and GMES, RMS as well. Those numbers at RPS, GMES, and RMS actually mirror within a percentage point the attendance we had last year at those. The high school is lower. And one of the things there, they did try a different system for this fall. There was a lot of, I think, good things that they were trying to put into place there. They did an arena conferencing, allowing parents to come in and talk to any teacher that they wanted to rather than just their CSR teacher, which Sometimes parents get a little frustrated going in and talking to the CSR teacher when they want to talk to the math teacher or they want to talk to the English teacher. But I don't think we did a really good job of sending out the message that that option was there and that you could come in and talk to any teacher and that you not could, but really should come in and talk to your teachers. So that option was there. And then the teachers also called and made appointments with the students in their classrooms that are really struggling already. And they did get a large percentage of those kids in, the kids that are struggling already in school, either attendance-wise or academically or just needing, you know, the parents that teachers felt like they needed to sit down with and have that conversation. They did special outreach to those parents, and they did get those parents in, and that some of them had conferences with a student, and maybe there was two or three teachers there to talk with the parent and kind of work as a team. So I think that part of it was good, but we still have some more work to do at high school to increase our participation of our parents with the kids in conferences. Next up, you've heard from the kids. I probably can't say it any better than them, especially referencing, you know, when the last time was that they keep on saying, oh, and the whole bit. When he said that to me this afternoon, I just cracked up. But they are very excited about their win against Montesano, and they should be. And they are also very excited because if they do win, well, I was corrected today. I thought it was the next two games that they would actually be league champs. But Tristan told me today that if they win the next game, they're league champs.
Nobody could catch.
Yeah, they're tied with Montesano at that point. So so it's a good season for football, and it's been a long time since they've been in that situation. I think overall what we're seeing is that our teams are more competitive this year, which is not a big surprise, but they're having better games. Soccer, you know, doesn't have a real good winning record, but yet their games have been really good games, really competitive games. Our volleyball team, which used to go to a game last year, and as Justin and I were talking earlier, you know, the game used to be over in a half hour, 40 minutes, and it was done. This year, they're going four games, and they're actually winning some of them, and they're playing right up to the winning point and you know, having some real good competitions. The golf team, you heard about the kids being at district, but the golf team is doing a really good job, and they were third in the league when you looked at the number of wins that they have. So we've got a lot of kids that are out having a good season. And Kevin Urich will be here in November to tell you more specifics about that. Europe grant, we talked about this in September, but I just wanted to mention again, really just that first bullet. When we talked in September, we thought we were getting one staff person. We have since done a lot more conversing with the people who are leading the grant. And we actually are going to have four staff people as a part of the grant. So those positions are going to be posted really soon. Two people who will be considered Gear Up advisors, and they will be really leading the program. And then we'll have two people kind of classified staff to help support the program with the kids. And again, this is a program that we're really going to be working with students in grades 7 through 13. To help them identify what are their career goals, what do they want to do after high school. And then the really nice piece about this is it says grade 7 through 13 because they will follow the students after they graduate. If they said that they were going to go and be an apprentice, then they're going to be following those students to make sure they get an apprentice programs. Or if they were going to go to a tech school, they're going to follow them. If they were transitioning into Centralia, they're going to be following students, especially those that they've identified that are going to need the support along the way. But this program will take kids to different places to have field trips and overnight trips to visit colleges, to visit different career options. It's a program that's really going to focus on helping our kids figure out the why behind what they're doing every day in school. So it's an exciting piece, and I'm thrilled that we're going to get four staff fully paid for out of that.
It's a seven-year grant cycle.
Seven-year grant. Mm-hmm. Yep, it's a $38 million grant, and I think there's eight school districts.
I think so.
Yeah. So, this is National Principals, School Principals Month. I just wanted to make sure that you were aware of that. Andrea has a fabulous Facebook post that's going out soon that's going to highlight our principals and some of their likes and loves and what they like to do with in life outside of being at school. And there's some really fun things that we're going to be able to learn about them. But our principals, they really do make a difference in our buildings. They create that culture. They're the why behind, you know, our teachers and our students thriving. They're working to bring the communities in. They work really hard every single day. So we just want to make sure that you're aware that we're celebrating them. And if you want to send them a note or say thank you, this would be a great time to do it. Veterans Day assemblies. So they're all coming up. I can put this in an email to you as well. But November 7th at 7:40 in the morning, that's at the middle school. November 7th, the high school will be doing something at that time. They're still finalizing it. They're looking at a few different things. So I will let you know when the high school lands. Grand Mound is doing it on November 7th at 2:15, and then RPS on the 8th at 9:05. And if you want to see it, great. I mean, they're all really good, but there's nothing better than watching the littles sing to our veterans. So it's a really special, heartwarming assembly. So, but all of them are good. And the high school is talking about inviting veterans in to do breakfast in the library with students, and then to possibly do a kind of a heroes parade through the high school, like they do for their state athletes, and then possibly do an assembly after that to do some education for the kids. But so more to come on that one. And then finally, our upcoming events. If you're interested in the haunted bus, it's on October 25th, and that happens over at the bus garage. And I want to give a shout out to First Student because they've been doing this, I know, at least 3 years now, and they really go all out. If you want to just go walk around and see some cool buses and bus drivers with their buses, you know, all decked out for Halloween, it's a fun evening. So 6 o'clock on the 25th. Trunk or treat at RPS on the 26th. We've got a board meeting on the 6th. There's a family game night at RPS on the 13th. That's also the same night as our strategic plan night. So Susie, you can't be there, sorry. WASA conference is on the 21st. And then Thanksgiving Bazaar at the middle school is on the 23rd, if you can believe that. So that's Saturday the 23rd. And then we have another board meeting on the 11th. That's what I've got.
So there's no November board business meeting on the fourth Wednesday.
Correct. Just on the
that's sixth. Standard.
Yep, you're right.
Always the day before Thanksgiving.
Yep. All right, you ready?
Okay, new business.
Okay.
New career and technical education plan.
This is approving the career and technical education plan, which we have to approve every year. And it basically is what Kevin presented to you tonight.
Oh, okay. All right. Do we have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Did I get a second?
I'll second.
We want to discuss anything? No discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? No opposed? Motion has passed. All right. This is the overnight out-of-state travel.
Yep. But when you approve this, then it allows us, when we have students who make state and have to travel the next week to go and compete, rather than us having to come back to the board and say, can they travel overnight? This gives us the ability that when the kids do have a competition or a national event like our robotics team going across the state, we can get things going and buy plane tickets and things quickly rather than having to wait for a board meeting to approve it.
Okay.
We'll do the question after.
Yep. Do I have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Can I get a second?
I'll second.
Second. Discussion.
When would something come then? If this is, I understand state happened after districts on a Friday and have to make reservations to fund it. But what, then it's just like when teachers want to go out of state for some training or something, that would come to the board.
Yes, or a camp. Yeah, basketball camp we've done. There are events. This is something that's been done every year.
So
yes,
just the
this is the
quick turn.
Oh, my gosh, they made state. We need to move.
We're not going
to
stop.
Right. Yeah. But we want the others to plan when they're going out of state and give us at least a month's notice. And that way, yes.
Okay. All right. Resolution.
I think you need
resolution.
To vote. We still have to vote.
Yeah. Oh, excuse me. Oh, I'm
disagreeing.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? No opposed. The motion is passed. Okay. Now can we go to the next?
You can.
Since I'm skipping a lot tonight here. All right. Resolutions for surplus office. Oh, okay. I remember this. The office space, the old gym, cafeteria, the room we rented out to the
cafeteria.
Yeah, no, the
Boys and Girls
Club and the
will be leasing.
Yeah, yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Do I have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Can I get a second?
I'll second.
And discussion. Any questions about it? Yeah. Nope. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No opposed. And so the motion passed. Okay. Public comment. Nobody's outside. Nobody's online.
Well, there's someone online, but I'm almost guaranteeing she does not want to come. Saying no. I see her head. She's saying no.
Oh, we'll go.
Yep. No. Nope.
Chicken.
No. Okay. She's fine.
No, I'm here as like a future admin.
Thanks, Francie.
Who's that?
Francie.
Oh, she's getting ready for hours.
Yeah.
Okay. If there was no comments, the board is adjourned. 9:12.